Well, it was a trickle to start with. It's kind of interesting that, you know, if you talk to people who are researching this manipulation, you'll find that they all came into this area of understanding from a completely different perspective. What happened to me is that when I started this spiritual journey in the early 1990s, I had lived a life, a very out there life. I had been a journalist. I had been a television presenter. I'd been a soccer player. I'd been right out there. And yet, this spiritual knowledge, which I was now learning about, I knew nothing about. So I asked myself the question, why is this knowledge not freely available? So I started looking at the suppression of spiritual knowledge and why it was that we didn't know about interdimensional reality, that we didn't know what there was to know about our consciousness and its relationship to the body, rather than the body being what we are. And when I got into that, I started to follow a trail, and the trail got wider and wider and wider and wider. And I started to see that all these apparently independent conspiracies and institutions of control and position were actually connected, and it was one gigantic web with a spider in the center of it, orchestrating it. So it was first of all trying to find out why spiritual knowledge is suppressed, and then it just led to everything else. And funnily enough, all these years later, the very foundation, as I said in my talk in Vancouver, the very foundation of the conspiracy is still the suppression of that spiritual knowledge that got me in here to start with. The suppression of knowledge that we are multidimensional infinity, that we have infinite potential to control our own destiny if you understand how to do it. And of course, if you want to control billions of people, and there's not many of you, then suppressing that knowledge is essential. You've got to get people to believe they are ordinary, powerless, and basically irrelevant non-entities. Just Joe Public, mate, what can I do? And then you're their controller. So when you look at the history, which I'm writing about, as well as the modern stuff, you find that the reason that this network, which controlled the arrival, occupation by the European nations of the Americas and South Africa and Australia and other places, the reason when those European nations went into these countries, they destroyed the ancient knowledge, they destroyed the native knowledge as much as they could. As a friend of mine in South Africa, a Zulu shaman, said, they milked the minds of the shaman and then killed him, is because they had to destroy vestiges, as much as they could, of what the native peoples knew about the true history of the world, and what they knew about the true nature of who we are and the nature of life. So this Illuminati network could, from Europe, create an illusion of history and an illusion of who we are, to disconnect us from essential knowledge through which we can express the full magnitude of who we all are. One thing I've learned many things, but one key thing I've learned is when the forces that control information and write history want me to look over there, I instinctively look over there. And when you do a bit more research into these witch trials, you find that those who were accusing these people of Satanism were themselves Satanists. And the people they were accusing were those in that community who had realized that they were Satanists and what was going on. And so they just reverse it, and then they create a situation in which the opposition is removed. And you know, this has happened all over the world. One of the things that you can follow with the Illuminati and the bloodlines through which they operate, from ancient Babylon to literally today and some of the most famous people in the world, is that satanic ritual, what we call satanic ritual, and blood drinking and human sacrifice, has been part, an absolute fundamental part of their modus operandi all the way through. And there has to be a reason for this. What people tell me is that these particular bloodlines, and you know, there's not that many of them at this level, they are the result of the interbreeding of a reptilian race thousands and thousands of years ago with the mammal-based human race. And the splicing of the DNA combination means that these particular bloodlines, and like I say, there's not many at this level, can actually move between reptilian and human form. And what they're doing, I understand from people who've been on the inside, is that they have the ability to open the mammal codes in the DNA and manifest as a human form while they're operating in mainstream society, and then switch back to their base form, which is a reptilian form, when they are in a position where they can do so without being identified. What's happening more and more, it seems, and I think it's to do with the vibrational change on the planet, which is increasingly being monitored, is they're finding it more and more difficult to hold that those mammal codes open and manifest in human form. And more people, I know from my own experience, are seeing this shape shift, this move from one form to another. And from what the people inside, on the inside tell me, and it's a number of different people now, for some reason, if they drink human blood, mammal blood, it helps them enormously. In fact, it seems to be almost essential to keep these mammal codes open so that they can hold human form in among the general public. And so it makes sense of why wherever you follow these bloodlines I'm identifying, from ancient Babylon to today, blood drinking and human sacrifice goes with them. And people knew some of the famous people that are into this stuff, it will make their hair curl. Or if it's curly, it will make it straight.
Well, why don't we have a look at some of these famous people and what their practices are?
Well, the one that comes up more than any other in relationship to shape-shifting and pedophilia and this ritual is George Bush. George Bush is one of these bloodlines that goes back to the ancient world. He is related to the Queen of England and the British royal family and massively involved in this. And interestingly, you know, when you look at the history of the Bush family, you're looking at so much of the history in the 20th century of the Illuminati network. His father, Prescott Bush, was one of the funders of Hitler. Prescott Bush was a major executive in the Harriman Empire, which also was the major funder in the first half of this century of the eugenics race purity movement. And the Rockefellers are massively connected into the Harrimans also. And it was the Rockefellers who funded a guy called Dr. Ernst Rudin, who had a whole floor of a university in Germany before the last war, who was Hitler's race purity expert. And the Harrimans brought him over to New York to a eugenics conference just before the war and gave him a major eugenics award for his work in Germany. Of course, it manifested as the race purity belief of the Nazis.
What can we do about this?
Well, you see, there's two ways of approaching something that you want to change. One is to find a solution for it, which is normally makes things worse. And the other thing is removing the cause of the problem, which I think is infinitely more wise. And the cause of the problem is that humanity has allowed itself not just to become a herd of sheep, but also a herd of sheep that's policing itself. You can only, if there's not many of you and you want to manipulate billions, you can only do it if you get the billions to keep each other in order. in the end, that the spiritual nature of human beings is both the key to how we've been suppressed, i.e. suppressing our knowledge of who we are, and it's also the key to how we can become free, which is understanding the true magnitude of who we are. And it's very clear to me anyway, and many, many increasing numbers of people, that there are cycles through which this planet goes through, and they are cycles of energy. And there are certain cycles which act like alarm clocks. They wake us up. I mean, the Mayans talked about these cycles, and one of their great cycles, which I think it started in 3113, is due to end in 2012. And the idea is that this particular cycle, as it comes to an end, brings to the surface all that's remained hidden, so we can move into another level of understanding. And certainly, the evidence is increasing that from about 1986, something called Schumann cavity resonance, which was discovered in 1899, the base resonant frequency, the heartbeat, if you like, of the planet has suddenly started increasing. It was pretty stable from when it was discovered in 1899 to 1986, and it's got faster and faster the longer the years have gone on. Now, what this has corresponded with, quite demonstrably, I've been in 25 countries in 3.5 years, and I've seen it everywhere, is that more and more people are suddenly waking up, and they're seeing the world in a different way. They have a different understanding of themselves. They are perceiving the world in a different way. I think over the next few years, the veil is going to lift, not only on what's going on in the world, but one reflection of that, and one cause of that, is the veil over our eyes is also lifting. And I think it's a wonderful time to be alive, and I think what's being exposed and the control is in its death throes, and it's going to happen quicker if you know it exists.